child. That was Mohamed Shahabuddeen. Of course, I was fairly young at the time, but he was a fixture among certain circles that my mom would frequent. And since she had a babysitter, I was always hanging around in those circles. And I remember him being quite erudite, but I remember he always had a very a smile on his face. He smiled as he spoke, which is very interesting to me as a child. And so it gives me the greatest pleasure this morning on behalf of the university, and I think on behalf of a country that should be very grateful to this towering intellect, to receive the books, the loving work of his beloved son, who we know adore him, and to receive it also from Said's cousin and niece, and Shahabuddeen's niece, Mrs. Correa, who did a wonderful job of not only presenting the book, but in a pleasant one for me. So we thank you for that. I'd also like to recognize the presence of her two daughters here this morning, because it's really important for us to recognize the youth among us, those who will carry the torch forward, and those who bear this legacy, this brown legacy. I'd like to, of course, commend the book, but to place it in the context of a growing canon of Caribbean work and regional work that is beginning to appear and which is most welcome. The voice of a people is resident in the work of their history, the spoken and written words of those who act in the public space and in the intellect that is often lost, because we as a people have not paid attention to the documentation and dissemination of what we write, what we think, and how we've acted. It is my own personal peeve that every single time I hear a speech in this country by any intellectual, a student, even big prime ministers and so on outside of Guyana, you hear in 1856, Thomas Jefferson said this. In 1400 or so,